And folks, we are back for the second half of a game in which the Saints are dominating rather handily, 21-0. I'm not surprised they're winning, but I am a little surprised they're dominating in such fashion. And it's, again, Coach, it's been both sides of the football looking sharp and playing their kind of a game. They've been dictating the pace and the tempo of this game, no doubt.
Yes, but like it's a game of two halves, so hopefully Secrets can come back and show everybody in Orange County why they're rated number one also. So we'll get it underway. We'll see from this half on.
Right to them. This time they handle it quite well, and it's return, but not much room there as the defensive team gets down quickly, and they flatten them around the 22-yard line. So back in the late 80s and 90s, all the way till maybe about 10, 11 years ago, everyone would start and everyone would have a week one game the Friday after Labor Day. That's not the case anymore. Everyone's starting early and then a bye week, and I kind of like it the old-fashioned way myself.
I do, too. I don't remember even having bye weeks when we came along when I was in high school.
That's a common thing. They have these week zero games, and I've seen some even week minus one week game.
Yes.
Minus one, yes. Number one.
That's true.
So they're allowed to start their summer camp a little bit early if you have a game that early. The pass is caught. Nice job out in the near flat. As a complete pass, about a good 8 yards there. It's pretty much all through the air. So, again, I would like to see them maybe try some of this short passing game. They really haven't tried that on the Saints here. They really haven't challenged them through the air all that much. Sigurdsson hasn't. Maybe they're going to readjust things and try to throw a little bit. Sigurdsson calls a timeout. That's not good. When you're down 21-0 and you're calling a timeout this early in the second half, that's a communication and a coaching problem. There's something wrong down there.
Yes, they showed you from up top to bottom, they got to get their mindsets together because, like I said, it's the first play of the game. I mean, certainly in a half, and come out as a second player and call a timeout. You might need that at the end of the game. That might cost you.
Some San Antonio Saints football history. They were 8-3 and 3-2, lost in the first round of the playoffs last season in 15. In the 14 season, they were 5-5 and only 2-2 in the league. I guess they had missed a league game or something there. 5-5 and 2-3, pardon me. In the 13th season, the last season under Carl Swanstrom, they were 0-10 and 0-5, 0-9 and 0-4 and 12. They only had four league games, and the same thing in 11. So they went through a number of seasons. They're three in a row, which they did not win a game, 11, 12, and 13. Maybe a yard or so on that one. That was they got the first down on the quarterback. Sneaky bulls his way forward, a little bit of a blocking help. Again, let's get to the lineman left to right there for the Jaguars in white and black pants, white shirts and black pants. Gabriel Mota, Jr., the only non-senior on the line, left tackle, left guard is Kevin Kabata with a C. Andrew Magana, Tilda over the end, senior, snapping that football, captain also, three-year starter. Paul Moore is a senior, he's the right guard, and the right tackle is Derek Liang. They put it up. Ooh, got hit right away. You know that you're going to get hit pretty quickly after you make that catch. Briseño on the stop there, nice job by him. Nice catch there. Nice throw. Nice all the way around. Keyshawn Allen made the grab. But Briseño was out in the open field and was right to him, and there was nobody to stop him. And down went the ball. So he made the catch, but no yards gained.
Great. Another,
that was a pretty no-gain play.
Oh, yeah. So, great job again by Briseño. Cornerback did a great job, heads up. Spotted the play, attacked it, and just like a post had been done. Great defensive play.
And he got up there quick. Yeah, their outside guys are having a good job in this defense here tonight, Santa Ana. They got the corners covered. I'm talking through the air and on the outside runs type of thing. Second and 14, they actually lost yardage on that play. It wasn't a no gain, it was a loss of yardage. A couple of guys in the defensive line cut down Julian Vagliente, who we haven't called his name out all that much here tonight. He's usually been a busier guy in most games before this one. And not seeing the level of touches that he usually sees. Maybe they'll involve him more as this game progresses. We're at the 10-minute mark. 10 minutes to go, of course, in the third quarter. Again, Peter Pigskin Hebda, along with assistant coach and Santa Ana High School alum, Tim Smith. Coach, you seem to know everybody in these stands here tonight.
Well, you're from Santa Ana. You know quite a few people. You've been around long as I have been, so.
Third and 13, look out. Avalos, the flag goes down. He's running for his life there. He just kind of falls down more than he allows himself to get hit. I don't blame him for doing that. You avoid getting the hit from a guy who's outweighs about 100 pounds. He knew he was going down anyway, so that was kind of a wise move, not a chicken move by any move. But we have a flag thrown, and that flag was thrown maybe halfway between the development of the play. And
yeah,
let's see here. I think they're calling us. I forget what that. I don't have the. Hang on. Are they waving it off? No. So it's going to be against Jaguars, so they'll be just Saints are going to just force the issue and just have them punt. So they're going to essentially decline it. So instead of third and long, it'll be fourth and long enough for a punt. So they've had some punting problems here tonight. Kicking game. Finally got off a decent one, a good one. It's to right to the returner, and the return team is the return defending team is right there, so no return there for the ever-dangerous number two for the Saints. Damian Macias, D-A-M-I-A-N. That's how it's usually pronounced when it's a first name. I've seen that last name spelled D-E with an I-E-N at the end in the past. Of course, there's a Damian High School in Laverne, which is eastern Los Angeles County. Catholic High School. Snap. Out of the shotgun. This is Briseño. A little bit of angled running here. Follows the lead block. Look at this huge lane. And he cuts to the outside. He gets chased out of bounds. Maybe should have cut in right there. But still great real estate gain nonetheless. 11 and 20. Let's see, about 31. About a 28-yard gain. Nice scamper by him. Man, this guy knows, he has a good nose for where to go really, really quickly. I mean, it doesn't take much for him to see where the space develops, and he's off and running. When you get out into high speed with that guy, look out. It's hard to bring him down. One guy's not going to hit him and bring him down in the open field like that, Coach. I don't think so.
Right. Very smart ball player. He's heads up, and like you said, he got much what he got out of the play, he gets out of bounds. It's cool. I think he's just trying to say, don't want to get hurt. You know, like you said, as sophomore or junior, he probably tried to bust all the way, but now he's running smart.
Yeah, he is. He's looking sharp, playing some good football out there. Alan Pacheco on the carry, kind of a dive forward to the left side there. Got about 7 yards. I thought it was less. Nice job. Second and three. That's a pretty good situation to be in. This is Briseño, a little stutter step into the side. He goes even farther to the side there, and he finally gets chased out of bounds. He got enough for the first down. It was second and three. He got about six. And again, this Briseño kid, what I like about him, he sees that front door is closed. And the next front door he tries is closed. He keeps on moving to the side until he finds some space, and he got all he could get out of that play. That was only a 6 yard gain, folks, but I would give him a sticker on his helmet for that one, because he got the most out of what he had available to him. No question about it.
Yeah, that's instinctively running. He's very talented. Like you said, he has a nose for the goal line, and he's very smart.
Yeah, he is. He's a very sharp player, knows where to go with it, and he just knows how to move in traffic, and he knows how to, what seems like it's going to be a busted run he makes the most of. Again, they're keeping it on the ground here, shaking it out in nice chunks here with a nice drive here on the ground. A couple more yards for the Saints. It's second and five. They got five on that one. I think that was, it wasn't a Geary. It was, look out, scampering to the right side, looking for some room. Clunks bodies with the guys downfield, knocks into a linebacker, goes out of bounds at around maybe the inside the 10. So it gets him down to about the, I think they're going to spot at the 6, yeah, about the 6 yard line. And that's another thing I like about Briseño. He's not afraid to put the first hit on you when you're a defender. He'll clash his pads with you, and you're going to stop me, I'm going to push you back.
Exactly.
Not a lot of running backs who like that. He is. I like that about him. There's a lot to like about him. Nice pitch here. It's kind of a fakeroo. Instead of being snapped to the quarterback, ooh, he gets slammed to the ground and hard from behind. Wow, you can see him going down not smoothly, not easily. That was, wow. That was Santa Ana's number 20, Alan Pacheco. I'm not sure what that thundering hit on him, but that was kind of seeing stars after that one. I think it might have been 34. It might have been one of the linebackers there for Segerson. 34 is Isaac Blas, B-L-A-S, 1-S. Second and goal from the 5. Shotgun snap. Macias takes it. Briseño takes the handoff from Macias. Off tackle to the left. Might have gotten a yard. They unpile the pile here. And again, the Saints just moving the ball downfield. And really continuing to dictate the tempo and the pace, and what we're going to do in this game has been all them.
Yes, they're steady attacking and taking it to them. Until you stop them, they're going to keep coming.
Exactly. Why change it? Shotgun, they come on third and goal. This is Briseño once again, and he goes in practically untouched on that nice long angled run. In he goes from about two and a half yards out. And the Saints taking even more firm command of this game here. Wow. Folks, we're looking at 27-0 with the extra point to come here, and we're not even halfway through the third quarter. Look out. Segerson really getting controlled. So the brothers Briseño lighting up here, especially big number 5, Jorge Briseño. Again, he's only late, but it was shown as 5'9", 185, but he seems bigger than that to me. He seems like, look out, a little bit of pursuit there, but Avalos comes up, and down he goes. He gets hit around the legs, and down he goes by compliments. But number seven brings down number seven, the brother seven. Marcos Avalos got hit and knocked down there by Joshua Brito, defensive back, junior, 5'7", 155 or so. Brito came up to make the hit, and Avalos came up to avoid the onrush of the defensive ends. So it's 28-0, and the Jaguars. You know, you got a bit of you could almost say two opponents down there. When you're down by four scores, all touchdowns. You know, you got the Saints and you got the clock. The clock is a bit of a factor when you're down by four scores. That's not a non-factor even this early in the game. Pass is just well overthrown, way incomplete. Intended for on a mid-range, to small to mid-range pass there, intended for J.C. Caravez. Yeah, Caravez was the intended guy, and it was just way over his head, and there was no way to pull that one in. So too much juice on it, or maybe he ran the wrong route. I'm not sure. Maybe there might have been a miscommunication. When you see something that incomplete, I'm thinking maybe perhaps the receiver ran the wrong route, some kind of miscommunication perhaps.
And not only that, you got to give credit coverage sack also, too. Defense sometimes do play a good coverage, so – that comes and has a lot to do with it also.
Yeah, that's true. You're right about that. Oh, look out. The ball is bobbled. And look, they scoop it up and they take it. That's a live ball. And the Saints are going to score a defensive touchdown. Thundering across is the big guy, the all-league player from last year, Steven Cruz. And Cruz cruises to the end zone. Wow. How about that? Defense, offense, and special teams. Getting it done in more ways than one. I'm pulling off all the rhymes today, Coach.
Sounds good.
Wow. How about that? Pounces on the loose football. He saw it squirt free, and he didn't hesitate for anyone. Scooped it up, and off he went. Touchdown, the Saints. It is 34-0 with halfway of the third quarter to go yet still. And this one has turned into a blowout. What can you say except the Saints they're hitting it big on all cylinders here tonight. Kick with more than enough room to spare. 35-0, and I got to admit, Coach, I'm not surprised they're winning, but I am surprised they're dominating. You know, he's talented.
Yeah, so when I first looked at him,
he's a great leader.
Good specimen. He's got all the aptitudes of a great athlete. He's tall, big, and he's definitely a football player. So his whole he has a very bright future. Yeah. If he stays dedicated and work out and take care of the classroom, he has a very bright future.
Let me tell you something, folks. I mean, when you're a high school hotshot, folks, they're not going to look at your 40-yard dash. They're not going to look at a 100-yard dash. They're not going to care about your statistics. They will care about your statistics as far as how many passes you can haul in or how many average yards per catch. You know that, Coach.
That's right. I always say one of my favorite things, you'd be walking down Bristol Street.
You're funny. Bouncing kick to handle it this time. Look out. Looking for some room down. No, he gets stumped. The first guy brings him down right around the side. He ran into his shoulder and his side and just blasted him, and the blocking help just wasn't there. So a good stop there. He's got to feel good about that one. That was Santa Ana's nice play on the defensive special teams by number 41, Miguel Leon. The brief pitch there, the quick pitch, doesn't work. Again, good penetration there. Briseño on the stop amongst also number pushing back for a loss of two or three. And also Saints Matthew Dorantes, linebacker, senior, 6'2", 200 pounds, raking havoc in the backfield there. Responsible for the Jaguars' loss as well. Good committee team tackling him and Briseño. So again, this pursuit of the defensive line of the Saints here tonight is...
Yes, there's no doubt about it. You can tell right now that Santa Ana is choking the life out of them. You can tell from the body language, the spirit. It's like you said, they're zapping all this... all the air they could breathe out of them. They're taking it to them.
Another way to put it is it looks like they're getting stronger as this game goes on. It looks like the Jaguars are kind of weakening, you could say.
Thank you for that. That's exactly the truth.
And this is unlike what I'm used to seeing with the Jaguars football. They've had a great season. Again, they're coming in undefeated. Again, the Saints are technically 8-0. They did have one loss, but again, the forfeit win against Orange, but they're having a great season nonetheless and capitalizing here. Every opportunity they've had, they've taken advantage in this game. In a big way, short field, as you saw the turnover, everything. Third and 12 from their own 18. Flags are thrown and whistles are blown. We've got a dead ball foul. And yep, they're gonna flag him for too much time. You can't do that. And you gotta be more conscious of the clock. So
both. See right now, what I feel is happening to Seagram is they've been in this position, like from behind when you're down 39-0 with 4 minutes and 19 seconds, the third quarter with 19 seconds left. They haven't been in this position, so it's unknown. But I know the type of coaching staff they have. They'll learn from this, and they'll come back ready to play next week. So whoever their opponent is going to be, they better be ready to strap it up.
Yeah, I think so. They'll probably be angry. I think they're on the road, too, for that.
Yes.
Santa Ana's got Ocean View next week. Or probably they had Ocean View last week. Probably they got Westminster next week. And Ocean View will play Seagram. My mistake. Seagram will play Ocean View in week 10. Third and 12 from the 18. After that, they call a timeout. So it's third and 12 still. There was no penalty. The penalty wasn't marked off, strangely. Pass is incomplete. It was, I guess they call it, timeout? Okay, they call a timeout in town. Okay, they threw the flag, but there was no penalty. They call a timeout in time. That's why it was still third and 12. Pass is incomplete. So they are to the right side of that field there, as you can see. And again, three plays and out or a very short drive either way. I would say that the Jaguars tonight, outside of maybe their first drive of the game, beyond that, maybe have a total yardage of maybe 50 yards, 55, 60 yards, and that's about it.
That's true, yeah.
Maybe 100 yards for the night, and that's it when you include that first drive, and that's all.
Yes, they've definitely shut them down, you know.
In a big way, in more ways than one. Here's the punt. Avalos under pressure, gets it away. Decent punt, decent height. Ooh, it takes a bit of a Santa Ana bounce, so they're going to try to down it right away. And again, a short field once again. Again, the Saints, I think that the Saints maybe had one drive early in the game from around their own 30 or something, and everything else has been at least at the 50 or beyond, and that's pretty unusual for any football game, really. You don't see that often, that frequently.
Right. Like, everything seems to be going your way, you know? That's what it seems like to me. No matter what they do, everything seems to go in the Santa Ana High School's way.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's been a bit of a weak kicking game here for Seagram, and it's caught up with them with the short field situation for the Saints offense. You know, their offense is high powered enough. Give a short field, it's only going to spell doom, and that has in this game so far. Macias takes it as he runs it all the way to the long side of the field, the right side. Out of bounds he goes at around the plus 37 yard line or so. Took it around the football. He did a lot of running for just a 3 yard gain. The thing I like about these Saints players, they're not afraid to take a hit. I mean, you can't be afraid to take a hit in football, but, you know, some of these guys that are outweighed by the defensive players by a good 40, 50 pounds, they know they're going to get a physics lesson in the process, but they don't back down.
No, and that comes with dealing with youth football programs. You know, you're used to getting hit, so they learn from early on it's best to hit them before they hit you.
Yeah. Holding is against the Saints, so that'll nullify only a 3 yard gain, so pushes them back. Let's see here. So they'll be looking at they'll retain the down. It'll be first down and about 18 to go because of the 3 yard. It's strange that they're marking it. Yeah, they're marking it first. They got to get down to about the 31 and a half yard line or 30 and a half yard line. Here's Pablo Aguirre. Aguirre makes again. He gets the grab. The flag is thrown off. The play is over. He was ensured to be down by about a couple of guys on the defense there. Main perpetrator on the play was number 34 for the Jaguars, Isaac Blas. It's against the Jaguars. Pablo Aguirre, I like it. You know, he's got the basics down, this kid Aguirre. I mean, no matter how many guys are swarming him, he makes sure he secures that ball first, and that's just good coaching, and that's just a smart player.
Yes, catch the ball, wrap it up, and get much as you can out of it. And the first thing, you catch the ball first, get tucked away.
I give the opposition a third of a second, to catch up to you, and maybe you're not going to get as many yardage after catch yards, but you know what? Make sure you got the football first. You don't want to turn it over.
That's right. No doubt about it.
That's just smart football. I like him. He does it right the right way. All right, first and 10, shotgun snap again. Macias hands off to Briseño. What else is new? Briseño kind of gets twisted around and swung around. Down he goes with about a 270-degree spin there. It does some damage for about 5 or 6 yards, I'd say. Not bad. As middle of the linebacking crew bring him down. And Santa Ana, by the way, 8 offensive returning starters on offense, 8 returners on defense. They have only 2 both-way players. Briseño is one of them. And with the Jaguars, it's a lot less. They only have 2 returning guys on offense and 1 on defense. And they have 2-way players as well. Down he goes early. Didn't fool too many people on that play. That was... I think number 20, who was that again? Pacheco? Yeah, Pacheco, Alan Pacheco, running back, junior, 5'5", 140. One of the smaller kids out of that offensive backfield, but plays with a lot of heart. And the Saints, again, up 35-0. They've dominated the line of scrimmage. They've dominated with the time of possession. They've dominated with the field position. They've dominated in every way imaginable, and they're dominating here, continuing to move it on the ground. Bassegno, a wide-open lane. He gets slowed there at around the ankles. Hung on for dear life around the ankles as he got turfed there by Seagram's number 13. And 13 is Paul Roa. Makes the stop. Bassegno goes down at around the, let's see, is it first down? No, it's second down, pardon me. He goes down around the 14-yard line. Yeah, about 13, between the 13 and the 14. They stay in shotgun snap, two out of the backfield, three receivers are in. Ball is given to the up man, and he gets creamed and smothered right away. You ain't going nowhere. They smother him quite well and quite quickly. Nice job. Main guy to lay the lumber there for Seagerson, number 34. He's having a pretty good gamer tonight, Isaac Bloss. He's been involved in a lot of stops. He's been busy. 2:04 and ticking here in the third quarter. 35-0 Saints. They want more. I wouldn't be surprised after this if they score here, Coach, another touchdown, if they maybe bring in the reserves. I would get those guys some playing time. Oh, yeah. Why not?
Get that experience.
Absolutely. That's very important. You never know when you need those guys. Down goes Bassegno. Gets caught from behind. Bassegno again gets down around the 8-yard line. Maybe about a gain of about 2. Not bad. You know you're going to come out a winner here tonight, barring an unforeseen miracle or disaster, or both. They are dictating everything about this one, and Bassegno tries to scamper in front of the pylon. He does. Probably did a little bit more of a wider run than he had planned, but doesn't matter. He's a good planner on. He's a good thinker on his feet. Let's just put it that way. He quickly adapts to Plan B and Plan C very fast. That's what I like about Bassegno. One of the many things I do like about him.
Yeah, I really love his football, both of them. They're very good football players. That's something that got a gift ability you just can't teach. This is a knack that they just have.
Coach, I got to ask you, I know you've been at Valley for a few years now with Coach Moore. He's a class guy. Everyone loves Coach Moore. He's got a bit of a gruff exterior, kind of a bit of a bark worse than his bite mentality. I know he's got a heart of gold, would do anything for his kids. But if the call ever came from your alma mater to coach here, what would you do? Didn't mean to put you on the spot, but I got to know.
Well, I mean, I love Santa High School. That is my school, and I'm always going to love the church. But right now, I love where I'm at right now. So it does cross my mind. So until I do ask that question, who am I with? Well, I'm a Santa Ana Saint, but I'm also a Falcon. So
I understand. Blowout. The hold is down, the kick is up, looks good to me. And this kicker is connected every time here tonight, playing a sharp game. And I'm not sure if he's in the shot, but Mike Tavangort is celebrating here tonight. He's barking to his players to just keep their head in the game and continue to play their game. Until only, I think, 1978 or 79 when the Arizona schools joined it. And a lot of people don't realize that they've only been in, those two schools have only been in the Pacific 12 only since the late 70s. They haven't been in it for its long, long history.
Black market, yeah, I know.
It was a Pac-8 for a long time. Bouncing kick once again. Deep man takes it. He's been in a familiar situation like this tonight. It's their seventh kickoff, or sixth kickoff. Little serpentine dipsy doodle running there. Nice job. Staying, bobbing, weaving his way through traffic. But there was a flag thrown well before the play ended. That was J.C. Cavarez He probably ran 100 yards on that return to get all the way up to the plus 45 yard line. I think this may be the first time, second at the most, that they've had it in plus territory, in positive territory. But again, we have a flag where usually things like a block to the side or a block in the back or a blatant clipping can happen. We'll find out. DeVantgord is definitely pleading his case with the officials here about what's happened. And it is against the Jaguars. So one of the nicest plays of the night is all for naught. Man, when it rains, it pours. What can you say? So we've had our share of penalties here tonight. Not a huge amount, but an amount that coaches probably don't enjoy seeing nonetheless. But again, the Saints, they win tonight. They'll win at least a share of their league. They should win the league outright. If they don't beat Westminster next week, they may wind up sharing it, but they'll certainly go at least as the number two team, the second place team out of the league. That's the worst it could be for them come playoffs time. Jaguars are still going to go, but they just won't enjoy a guaranteed first round home playoff game. We will see. Of course, there's one more game yet to play, and this one's not over yet. 1:15 remains in the third quarter, first and 10 for their own 23. This is the Jaguars looking for some room down the middle. Nothing doing, nothing going. The penetration is there. Up the middle they go, and they get stuffed out very quickly, very early, maybe a yard and a half, if that. Coming in there and creaming them was number 45, Kevin Cea, C-E-A, or Kia. And he's been double teamed to a certain degree all night. You know, we haven't called his name out, but he's really one of their best players on that defensive line. But yeah, when you take two guys to neutralize him because he's so big and he's so strong, that leaves things open for other players. We've seen him, that kind of has been the case for the most part here tonight, Coach.
That's correct. Until you put two on one, that frees up somebody.
So, you know, he's kind of an unsung hero out there a little bit. This is Avalos. He's been under pressure all night long. He's under pressure here, and down he goes. They register a sack finally. They push him back to what, the 20-yard line. Not a huge loss. They snapped it to 24, but a sack nonetheless. Negative yardage. As one of the Seagerson players gets a rear end pat from one of the Santa Ana players, number 15 there. Leo Busio. And Busio, one of the outside guys, outside linebackers. Actually, Busio is listed as defensive end. But he's kind of one of those rovers where he can drop back into the linebacking position too. Both are having good seasons, but you wouldn't know from the look of it tonight. Going skyward once again. Here is Avalos, puts it up. It's caught. He led his receiver just a little bit. He made the catch, but did he get it? Yep, he made the catch. You know, of course, in high school football, all you have to have is 1 foot in bounds and you're in bounds. And that one was well timed. That was a pretty play. So the Seagerson Jaguars, that probably is their longest gain of the night by far in one play. And that was caught by, J.C. Cavarez. They're going to a huddle here. They want to get some points. Going down the middle here out of the double wing formation, dragging guys with them. All of a sudden, they look like the Jaguars of old in suddenly in two plays. Down the middle, right down between the tackles. They get about, did they get 10 or did they get 9? I think they're going to move. So two plays, two first downs, and a gainage of about 33 yards, and they're coming out of no huddle. Maybe they should do this no huddle more often. Maybe they should do this next week. They kick out here. Single back set man takes it, goes down the middle here, kind of loses his balance more than he gets hit, but still about a gain of about 6 or 7 as he glides his way down to about the 30-yard line before he's hit and knocked down by a couple of the linebackers, including number 3 there for Santa Ana, Matthew Durantes. And Jaguars looking at second down and about 5 yards. Flags go down as whistles sound, probably a line of scrimmage infraction or something. Maybe somebody line up in the neutral zone or something is my guess. And so all of a sudden, the Jaguars.
Also, so I'm saying Santa Ana did. They're starting to put in a substitute players also too right now. So
they're trying to take advantage of that. The Jaguars are. And there are a couple of reserves on the field, not totally, but some for the defense. Pardon me. And they're discussing, the officials are, what the infraction is. Usually when it's a line of scrimmage infraction like that, it's not usually that much discussion, but let's see how much they... All right, they're not... I guess there was no flag. Are they waving it off? Usually they'll wave off. They'll just take the flag and wave it as a no penalty, but I didn't see anything marked off. So I'm going to guess that's an Emily Latilla penalty, folks. Never mind. It's a Saturday Night Live from back in the late 70s. Now we have flags and whistles. Well, we have whistles first, then the flag is thrown late. The officials seem to be having some kind of communication problem down there, so I'm not sure what's going on. the previous penalty was a non-penalty. This is a penalty against the Jaguars. So they are marching it off 5 yards. It'll be, instead of second and five, it'll be back to second and 10. We're back to 10 yards for first down, I should say. As 9:22 and the clock continues to tick here in this relatively moving, quickly moving football game. It's been run dominant. We've seen the Jaguars put it up very few times here tonight, maybe five or six, and that's maybe four or five times, and that's been about it. As their running game has not worked, but they've stayed with it, but maybe they should have adjusted to the pass. Of course, they're missing their best receiver, Gus Guerrero. He's an exciting player. He's been out since the Laguna Beach game with multiple fractures and breaks of his MCL and I think of his part of his leg. Man, he got blasted hard. I mean, that was a head of steam coming in on that one. He gets up slowly, too. I hope he's okay. I think he is. But he's going to remember that one, I'm sure. Wow. He got hit hard. That was, I think, number three in the dash. Didn't go anywhere. No room. Keyshawn Allen, and again, he got hit hard. You could hear the fans just kind of oohing on with that hit. It was clean, but it was vicious. Down he went, no gain. He's got to be feeling that one still a little bit. That's one where you're getting the whirl. That's a play where you get in the whirlpool to get out the kinks and the sores tomorrow, the aches and the pains. That's what the whirlpool is for. Heated up nicely for a hit like that. Ooh, nice timing pass here. Nice catch there over the defenders and before the defensive backs, after the linebackers and before the defensive backs. Nicely timed play there. That was a pretty one. Nice grab there. He's got a good placement to his passes when he puts it up. This kid Avalos is a poised player and is a good thrower, but they just don't call on him all that much because of the type of offense that they run. Oh, we got a guy down on his front there, on his belly. I hope he's all right. He was caught there, nestled in the arms there, and he kind of leads his players to his Emerson Aldana on the grab, the tight end. And we got a guy flat on his front there, and he looks like he's motionless. Don't know what's going on there. Maybe there's the wind knocked out of him or something, but he's not moving. This is not good. This is not good. And I don't want to stab a guess. I think it's number 75, but I'm not certain of Segerstrom. Kevin Kabata? Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's him. He's one of the linemen, of course. He's Kevin is the left guard. And yeah, he's flat on his front, and I don't see motion from him. So they got the trainers and a couple people tending to him, of course. We'll see what's going on. This is going to be scary. The Saints, of course, taking a breather on their side of the field. There is an ambulance here on site. Not all high schools have that. Now he's up, and he's sitting on his rump, and he's looked like he's dazed, though. I'm sure he'll be marched off the field and looked at, certainly, but hopefully he won't need an ambulance. Well, that's always good to see these on his walking out under his own power. So again, they're getting the wind knocked out of you. I've had it happen many, 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 many moons ago when I played high school football. It was a couple eons ago, but when you have the wind knocked out of you, which is what I'm guessing happened to him, that's a frightening thing. It's until you've had it happen, you really don't know how it feels. Any football player that has had it happen knows what I'm talking about. So they march him off. Looks like he'll be okay. Nothing serious, terribly, or anything broken. That's good. Fighting, clawing, scratching for yards right down the middle, right down the lane, right up the gut. And Cruz on the tackle there. Number, who was that? Segerstrom's number five, Angel Lopez on the dash. Gets about an extra 3 yards. It's the first time you can say, Coach, that it's second and goal to go here for the Jaguars here tonight.
Yes, it shows you no quitting them, so that's the signs of a good team.
Well, it's good to see them able to move the football late in the game here, even though it's kind of a semi-lost cause. They go off tackle, a little bit of left side. They have those cutouts and those cut-ins, those runs where they look like they're going to go to the outside lane, they cut in, and they get down closer to about the 2-yard line, so from about the 3 to the 2, maybe a gain of 1. As they need a little more blocking help down that middle here. I wouldn't be surprised if they go. I wouldn't be surprised if they go to the air here. Wouldn't shock me. Because again, the Saints have had their way in a good way with these guys. They come up with two backs, and they go to the left side there. Kind of a loss on that one, maybe of a yard or two. And they had the guy right behind the quarterback, and then they had one running back to the right side, but they ran that play to the left with the guy who was right behind the quarterback to the tailback, you could say, and didn't fool anybody.
No, great penetration by the people up front. So I wouldn't be surprised they call a timeout right here because I know they want this score.
They want to get in that end zone. They don't want to see a goose egg in the on the web and in the newspaper tomorrow. Orange County Register. They just for morale, they get a score here. 6:09 and counting. They probably will call a timeout because that play clock is really ticking down on them quickly. They're gonna, second and goal from the two, or fourth and goal from the two versus fourth and goal from the seven is a bigger order. They gotta snap it here. Did they call timeout in time? They did. Well, that's a burnt timeout. Well, that's all right though. They can afford it. I mean, Sigerson's last timeout. So, again, in a game like this, it doesn't really matter. It's your last timeout. You're down by six touchdowns, Coach. But
yeah, it's the sake of the team pride. We want to score. You know,
might as well call it. Let's get a touchdown. Let's see if we can get a score before the night is out.
That's right. That's true.
When you have a game like this, if you're the Seagrams coaching staff, I mean, in a game in which you really expected to compete and had a chance, felt you had a chance to win, you really did. After a game like this, I mean, of course, you're not a head coach, you're an assistant coach, but you're in coaching nonetheless. I mean, what do you say? I mean, what do you say to kids like this when it's an underperformance this much imbalanced?
Well, to me, it might sound crazy. It's good sometimes in league to lose because once you get that taste of the feeling, you have that hunger, you don't want to taste that feeling anymore.
Right.
So you come back even stronger. So you always got to find something bright out of the bad things. And I look at it, I know Seagrams is a heck of a football team. Yeah. And like to have a record being like with them 8-1, I mean, come on, I applaud that. So, you'll get down so long. So.
Yeah. Well, that's a good take. Don't remember how this feels because you don't want to have it happen again. I like that kind of approach by a coach. Flag is thrown as the play ends. And I think he's short of it. That was, trying to dive over there was Angel Lopez. And the flag, just a massive pile of bodies down there. It's hard to see what the flag was. It was thrown right before the play ended. I guess some backfield stuff or something.
They're walking on. I don't know. I don't know what the penalty flag could be because it's 4th-and-1. I mean, it'll be a not a smart play for a defensive player to make a mistake.
Okay, personal foul is face masking against the Saints. I didn't see it happen. So that'll set up 1st-and-goal from the 1, as it should. And, you can't have that happen. Of course, face masking is a dangerous thing. And when you get around the neck, that's a delicate part of the body. That's why it's a 15-yard penalty. In this case, of course, it's half the distance to the goal. But if it was in the open field, you would see him marching out 15 yards. And, of course, that's how players can get hurt very easily. The neck is one of those areas that's it's all muscle and it's all unprotected. You're vulnerable there. And, of course, a lot of those players like to wear those collars. A lot of running backs like Dickerson used to wear that neck collar for the back of your neck. Helps you, minimize any thrashing back in the neck on a sudden hit from the front. They go on goal to go here. From the 1, are they across? They are across, barely, but they get through. And the Seagrams and Jaguars can finally say that they have crashed Pater here tonight. And then it was Santa Maria on the carry. As in he goes, touchdown, they get their 6 points with 5:12 remaining here in the game. Again, you're watching this game on SAUSD TV, Channel 31, and also the web streaming service here for the city, or the school district, I should say, of Santa Ana. And we have a player down, unfortunately. And I think it's a Seagrams Jaguar player. Can't see who it is. Can't see the numeral just yet. But he's flat on his back. So the Saints sending a message to the rest of the league and everything that we are for real, we are here to compete, and we can beat good teams. They're doing it here tonight. Players up and walking under his own power. So we're seeing a few players drop here tonight. And just can't get a look at that numeral just yet because the angle he's walking. I wish I had his name for you. I think that was actually Avalos. Yeah, that was Avalos 7, the quarterback. So he's all right. Yeah, that was him. Yep. Avalos not a super tall guy for a quarterback, and he's kind of a wide build for a quarterback, too. He's not as tall as most quarterbacks and not as slender as most quarterbacks, but he's tough. He's a good player. He can throw a pretty pass when they call on him. I like him. He's a 3-year starter. This is his 3rd season as a starter on the varsity. So he's an experienced player. When you're a quarterback that's in a double wing, in the double wing offense like they so. But, of course, Seagrams has always been a run-dominant school. That's just the way they run things and do things. Here's a return, Pablo Getty. I think this is his first kickoff return of the night. Tries to find inside lane, sees it close, takes the outside lane. He's still on his feet, still going. Finally gets knocked out of bounds, but not before the damage is done. He gets his guys all the way to about the minus 47-yard line. Not bad. And again, these guys No.
Running clock, I guess.
Oh, okay, I think you're right. We do have the running clock. So I guess, yeah, that's a coach's agreement that they, yeah, both coaches have to agree to that. You know, one usually will suggest it. It's not always a winning coach that suggests it. But he did get run out of bounds, but it is a running clock. So Seagram Jaguars, this game will end a lot quicker that way. And, of course, it's in a game when it's a lopsider. So I think we got some more reserves in here for the Saints. Looks like we got some reserves on the line there, the offensive line, I think. This is Briseño, so the talent kids, the kids that getting the most of the touches stay in. And he gets thumped there early. Gets helped up by one of the Seagerson players. Always good to see good sportsmanship. Wreaking havoc there and laying the lumber kind of early for Seagerson. Big number 74. Andrew Magana, again, a both ways player, plays on offensive line and defensive line. If there's any guys that have got to be tired at the end of a game, it's somebody who plays on both lines, both sides of the ball. That's got to be one sore guy on a Saturday morning at the Whirlpool when the coaches have him in the next day, I would imagine, Coach.
Oh, you wake up in the morning and it's like you've been hit by a freight train. You don't know, you find bruises on your backside, don't remember getting hit there, or your ribs. Yes, you feel it the following day.
There you go. Look out, Briseño, and again makes his decision quickly. Goes to that left side, still on his feet, and he gets chased out of bounds. Not really brought down at all. And Briseño gets chased out of bounds there by Sigurdsson's 2 and 3, Keith Morales and Keyshawn Allen. Allen again a both-way player for him as well for the Jaguars. And again, I like that quick decision making. That, you know, the second, third option. You know, these Saints they find these guys out of their offensive backfield really make the most out of every play that they run. I mean, I just like how they go after the secondary and the third dairy, if you want to call it that, spaces that they can find where they get. They're just great at getting the most yards you can out of every play. I'm impressed.
Yes, everything's attack, attack, attack. You know, you can just see there's no slowing down. He's steady coming at you,
yep,
each and every play. So you can't. What I'm trying to say, you can't stop it unless you're going to stop it. They keep coming, and you know it. So
that's Briseño right down the middle. He kind of gains yards as he goes down. Has some good blocking help there, not bad. A couple guys involved in the stuff there for Seagerson, including Keyshawn Allen. Again, the running clock continues. It continues even after the previous play went out of bounds. So, again, clock usually will stop when the ball goes out of bounds. But, again, we've got the running clock. So, for the game to end earlier, as we see. So, you see that every now and then when a team is up by usually 30 points or higher, as is the case here. It's 42-6. And Seagerson, of course, missed their extra point. All right, 2nd and 7 from the plus 30 yard line. Saints stay in shotgun. One guy in front of him, one guy in back. And somebody moved before the ball was snapped. Flags go down as whistles sound. I think it was It was 65. We don't mean to notice him when he makes an error, but he probably thought it was Hut 3, or probably thought it was Hut 2 and it was Hut 3.
Right.
That's my guess.
Yeah, whatever, he had the wrong Hut.
There you go. You had the wrong count. So get the wax out of your ears. That sometimes happens. Sometimes that's all it is, literally and figuratively, folks. That's the truth. Sometimes a guy might hear something else. So 2nd and 12 from the 36, the plus 36 for the Saints. Three receivers are in, two to the right and one to the left of Macias, the quarterback. Taking his time on a snap here. Give this to the deep man, Briseño. Briseño dragging a couple guys with him. Not bad, a couple yards. Gets past the original line of scrimmage. And again, they're just waiting for a merciful end of this game. The Jaguars are. So we'll see one play, at least more run. And I'm sure the Saints are going to be happy, more than happy, to leave this building, their home field, Santa Ana Municipal Stadium, Eddie Westfield, with a 42-6 victory. Who expected that? I didn't. I thought we were going to have a tough, tight one here tonight that was relatively low scoring. It's a good thing I don't bet high school football.
Me either, because you never know what can happen out of these guys. You never know what you're going to get. That's what makes it so exciting, you know?
I don't bet college football. I don't bet pro football. I don't even play fantasy football. I don't bet. I'm too afraid of losing money. I'm afraid I get addicted to it. All right. Give is to Briseño once again, looking for some room on that left side. Doesn't take the inside lane, takes the outside lane, falls down at around the 23-yard line or so, and he gets upended there. And again, flag is down. And a lot of times when the Briseño guys, when they take these runs, Coach, a lot of times it's not them getting hit. It's just them, you know, getting chased out of bounds,
right,
or
right,
just clunking by one guy and losing their balance. It's not
right.
I would say at least one-third of the time that he's runs the ball when his motion is stopped, it's not because of a tackle.
Right, right.
That's
he's very
a good
smart,
running back.
Tremendous running back, getting ready for the next play, next game.
Folks, this game is over. The running clock finally is at zero, and the Saints ring the Saints church bells, folks, because the Saints are victorious in a huge way. 42-6 here at home. And what can you say, Coach? All I can say is they dominated this one in every way, and in every way possible, from start, from the starting bell to the ending whistle. This one was one for the books and one for the history books for them in a big way. They beat a good team at home in dominating fashion.
Yes, like I said, Santa Ana is a very dangerous football team. They got so many weapons, a great coaching staff. Like I said, it's hard to beat them. I got to take a hat off to them. I was impressed from kicking team, the running game, the football, the defense. I was totally impressed with this football team.
I am too. Folks, 42-6, the Briseños, Macias, everybody. But give it some offense. Let's give some serious credit to their special teams. Look sharp tonight. And their offensive and defensive lines absolutely dominated this game in more ways than one. They gave up a few plays here and there, but I'm just guessing total yardage for the Jaguars here tonight was maybe 150 yards. If you take away the fact they were going against defensive reserves and you take out that first drive of the game, they might have had 50 yards and that was it.
Yes.
They really took it to them. I mean, again, not surprised the Saints came out a winner here tonight. I am very surprised they won by 36 points. And this sends a message to a lot of the other schools in this conference that they're not going to be a tough out in the playoffs. No way.
No. You got to, like I said, you got to play your best game of football. They're very talented. And like I said, you got to play your best to beat them. That's why you're not ranked number one. Just to be ranked number one, there's a reason why for that.
Let me tell you something, folks. The Saints have had their dry years. We've talked about their past records in recent seasons, folks. Hit the history books, hit the record books. I'm not sure when the year was, but the Saints have a chance to go undefeated in their season. Again, there was a forfeit win in there, but they still had that was a game in which they only lost by 2 points against Orange. But when was the last time that the Saints finished undefeated? I don't know, but I'm sure it's been a long time, Coach.
You got me on that one also, and I'm a Saint.
I don't know. Well, we want to call it a night here tonight. Again, the final score, Santa Ana 36, Segerstrom. Pardon me, the Santa Ana Saints 42, Segerstrom 6. They win by 36, and this is one team that is gelling very nicely here late in the season, right when a coach wants his team to be gelling.
That's true. That's true. But also, I want to give credit for Segerstrom and their program. Like I said, being 8-1, that's no slouch. They have a heck of a football team over there with a great coaching staff.
Loss.
And you'll hear from them. They're not done yet. Trust me.
No, they're not. I think that they'll regroup, and they got a game against Ocean View next week. That certainly should be a winnable game for them. But the Saints are in the driver's seat to finish as the number one slot out of this league. If they will lose to Westminster next week and the Jaguars win, it could be a try. A tie or a tie amongst three if Westminster wins tonight. I'm not sure where they're playing here tonight on Friday night, October the 28th, ninth week of the season. We want to say goodnight here, folks, as the Saints are playing their theme song, their school song, after a big victory. My name is Peter Pigskin Hebden for Coach Tim Smith. Thanks for joining us, folks, and we'll catch you the next game. Good night.
Pick that up now. There's a trash can up in the front, but don't leave trash behind. Do not leave. Thank you.